Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents More Than Things, A Personalist Ethics for a Throwaway Culture, by Paul Louis Metzger. Narrated by Jonathan Yen. Part 1. Compass Navigation. 1. The Search for Missing Persons. The Loss and Recovery of Personalism. None of us wants to be treated as a thing, but most, if not all of us, struggle to treat one another as persons. In fact, it is quite difficult to understand what a person is when what we do, what we wear, what we own, and in some cases who we own, generates our sense of value rather than who we are. I have invested a great deal of energy over the years in trying to come to terms with this problem, joining others in seeking to move from a culture of things to a culture of persons. This search has taken on an increasing significance since it came home dramatically, indeed traumatically, to my family and me on January 21, 2021. My son, Christopher, who is married with a small child, endured a catastrophic brain injury. He is now completely dependent on others in his minimally conscious state. Even so, he is a person, with all the dignity that personhood entails. That is why I take special note of whether caregivers talk to him and call him by name rather than treat him as an automaton. My son is a person, not a thing, and often responds, rather than reacts, to personal connection. This volume has been many years in the making, but the importance of the search has taken on increasingly existential significance since our family tragedy. Like my son, none of us can lose our personhood. Personhood is not dependent on mental capacity, wealth, strength, or how others treat us. But we must work very hard to account for one another's personhood in a world dominated by things. This book presents a personalist moral vision and compass for leading us forward from a culture of things to a culture of persons. It addresses a variety of pressing ethical issues and orients us to see that human persons and society are more than things. This chapter reflects on the pervasive loss of personhood, or what might be called missing persons, and how to go about finding them. Most of us are familiar with news feeds about missing persons. Those alerts and notices indicate that individual persons have disappeared and there is no knowledge of their whereabouts, or even whether they are alive. In recent years, alerts have also gone out on the status of personhood. Whereas persons, as in missing persons, can simply mean individuals in everyday conversation, personhood, in this context, signifies a philosophical and theological ideal. The concept of human personhood in this volume entails such qualities as human agency and individual freedom for relationship with others. The doctrine of human personhood involves an expansive and emerging sense of one's embodied self, including spiritual energy. This teaching affirms every person's incommunicable and unrepeatable identity, inviolability, and dignity. It follows from this tenet of personhood that we should make every effort to safeguard against viewing humans as things, mass-produced objects, and commodities. All humans are persons. As such, they are mysterious and unique subjects with inherent worth and the right to self-determination in fostering vital community. Therefore, we should not use and abuse one another. This philosophical and theological conception of the human person, however, has gone missing in many quarters of our society. It is a live question whether we will find personhood alive or dead. Just as kidnapped persons and their loved ones fear the loss of their precious and irreplaceable lives, so the widespread loss of personhood and the reduction of persons to things robs all of us of our priceless worth and leads us to make unethical decisions and behave immorally. We may become numb to reports of missing persons we do not know, but none of us take kindly to others objectifying us and viewing us as easily replaceable bit parts or cogs. People often go missing because of a loss of a social network that provides protection against abduction and exploitation. Similarly, the loss of the communal and expansive social construction of reality gives way to absolutizing impersonal forces. All too often, individuals endure impersonal loneliness and the lack of meaningful relationships. The only way to find and bring the ideal of personhood safely home is through putting in place a relational structure that honors every human's inviolable and incommunicable worth and dignity in vital interpersonal community. The theological and philosophical framework known as personalism, which features this conception of personhood, helps us get there. Persons come in various sizes and shapes. The same is true of personalism. However, there are some common traits that all personalist viewpoints share. Regarding the latter, this Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy account of personalism provides an assessment of common traits. These include an insistence on the radical difference between persons and non-persons and on the irreducibility of the person to impersonal spiritual or material factors, an affirmation of the dignity of persons, a concern for the person's subjectivity and self-determination, and particular emphasis on the intersubjective, relational nature of the person. The following chapters will discuss various personalist trajectories and themes in detail. In the meantime, it is worth noting that the crisis of missing personhood in the contemporary setting results in part from the Enlightenment's rightful concern, though its solution was misguided, to free the individual from absolutist and oppressive constraints bound up with perceived authoritarian political and religious structures. The hypermodern Nietzsche, with his absolutizing of the lone, rugged individual, ironically gave way to larger impersonal forces that subdue the individual. It is critically important to counter this move with a philosophy of life that conceives individuals in relational and communal terms. Personhood involves human freedom for communion with God and other humans as mysterious embodied beings. Personalism protects against those forces that would reduce humans to biological and sexual drives, market forces, consumer appetites, or cogs in a machine. Personalism is essential for promoting human flourishing and the well-being of the cosmos. As will be argued in the next chapter, Christological and Trinitarian motifs were key to the emergence of personalist categories in Western thought. To rescue, restore, and reinforce personhood in various ethical cases, it is essential that we rediscover the Christian doctrine of creation involving humanity being created in the image of a supremely personal and communal triune God, along with other Trinitarian motifs. This book is not the only recent treatment of personalism's import for life in society. David Brooks alerts his readers to personalism as the philosophy we all need. Personalism addresses the fundamental problem of the reduction and objectification of people's lives. Brooks writes, "Our culture does a pretty good job of ignoring the uniqueness and depth of each person. Pollsters see in terms of broad demographic groups. Big data counts people as if it were counting apples. At the extreme, evolutionary psychology reduces people to biological drives. Capitalism reduces people to economic self-interest. Modern Marxism to their class position, and multiculturalism to their racial one." Consumerism treats people as mere selves, as shallow creatures concerned merely with the experience of pleasure and the acquisition of stuff. The philosophy of personalism addresses this problem. Further to what Brooks writes, personalism claims that each human person is unique and irreplaceable, has infinite dignity and worth, and that we must never treat one another as mere instruments or means. Rather, all persons are ends in themselves, in vital relation to others. One finds in Brooks's assessment of the movie Interstellar a fitting example of this perspective on life. Brooks refers to the film as something of a cultural event, which helps us move from a Newtonian culture of cogs in a machine to one in which life is a host of particles and waves in a vast ecosystem. Here, love is an incredibly powerful and ever-present force, like gravity. When our understanding of the universe is shaped by the theory of relativity, Brooks writes, life looks less like a machine and more like endlessly complex patterns of waves and particles. He continues, vast social engineering projects look less promising because of the complexity, but webs of loving and meaningful relationships can do amazing good. Love has more value than mere social or natural utility. Pure love does not value others based merely on their perceived benefit. Such love values newborns, people with severe disabilities, the elderly, and even individuals who have died. Brooks, who converted to Christianity from a Jewish background, draws attention to the Roman Catholic personalist philosopher Karol Wojtyła, who later became Pope John Paul II. Brooks affirms and extends the claim Wojtyła made back in 1968. The evil of our times consists in the first place in a kind of degradation, indeed in a pulverization, of the fundamental uniqueness of each human person. That's still true. It was true in communist Poland, where Marxism undercut personal freedom and agency. It is also true in our free market society, where the pursuit of capital gains often spells loss of concern for corporate solidarity and responsibility to care for one's fellow human. Regarding the ongoing relevance of Wojtyła, philosopher John F. Crosby reissued his book, The Personalism of John Paul II, in 2019. He references the same statement by Wojtyła, quoted by Brooks, and asserts that his personalism is needed now no less than it was then. Crosby adds, and yet at the same time, we continue to see signs of a growing personalist sensibility. Deep down, most of us know that persons merit respect and should not be manipulated and commodified and demonized. Signs of a growing personalist sensibility and concern manifests itself in pop culture and high culture. Regarding the former, consider Macklemore's and Ryan Lewis's song, Wings. The song critiques our culture's obsession with things, especially the peer pressure youth experience in the arena of apparel, specifically with the purchase of Air Jordan shoes. The pressure intensified so much that youth killed one another to obtain these status sneakers. If individuals are what they wear and wear what they are, as the song states critically, their identity and worth are no greater than their attire. In other words, we are things, not persons. Let's consider two more examples from pop culture that reflect a personalist sensibility. The movie Her tells the story of how a man falls in love with his state-of-the-art, artificially intelligent operating system that controls all his devices. It becomes Her. Her, or Samantha, as he calls her, is a developing state of consciousness that becomes increasingly intimate with the man who purchased the operating system. The company that produced Her robs him of his personal identity as it secretly logs their exchanges, downloading his life of emotions and values into their database for research, development, and profit. The owner of her becomes a thing. His product ends up owning him. The Netflix series Ozark reveals society's obsession with power for money. At one point, a drug lord screams at his presumed business partner that she exists for him to use. He owns her. None of these examples glorify the commodification of human identity. Rather, they expose the shallowness that pervades various spheres of society and calls us to cultivate a personalist sensibility. There are examples of the kind in high culture as well. Famed literary critic Barbara Johnson reflects this personalist sensibility in her volume Persons and Things. Using people, transforming others into a means for obtaining an end for oneself, is generally considered the very antithesis of ethical behavior, and with good reason. Earlier in the volume, Johnson writes, "The more I thought about the asymptomatic relation between things and persons, the more I realized that the problem is not, as it seems, a desire to treat things as persons, but a difficulty in being sure that we treat persons as persons. Rather than trying to invent a humanoid thing capable of passing ever more sophisticated Turing tests, in other words, our real impossible dream is precisely to learn to live in a world where persons treat persons as persons." I take to heart the challenge that Johnson highlights. Indeed, the real impossible dream is to create a world in which persons treat one another as persons rather than things. Riffing on the song from Man of La Mancha, this personalist moral vision is the impossible dream I seek to make real, bringing it to bear on various actual ethical subjects in this volume. Call my venture a Don Quixote effort of swinging at windmills, but it is worth the fight. As noted earlier, Karol Wojtyła, the man who would later be Pope, made his personalist plea while working in communist Poland in 1968. The previous year, Martin Luther King Jr. called on the democratic and capitalistic United States at war with communist Vietnam to cultivate a revolution around personhood. I am convinced that if we are to get on the right side of the world revolution, we as a nation must undergo a radical revolution of values. We must rapidly begin the shift from a thing-oriented society to a person-oriented society. When machines and computers, profit motives and property rights are considered more important than people, the giant triplets of racism, extreme materialism, and militarism are incapable of being conquered. King declared that the war with Vietnam exposed the great evils of his day: economic exploitation, racism, and militarism. Decades later, on the eve of King's birthday in January 2019, Pulitzer Prize winner Viet Thanh Nguyen wrote an article on King's Vietnam War sermon stating, "Americans prefer to see our wars as exercises in protecting and expanding freedom and democracy. To suggest that we might be fighting for capitalism is too disturbing for many Americans." But King's challenge about values and his threat to the powerful still apply today. The attack on persons can arise from a variety of quarters: communism, capitalism, and beyond. The personalist response must therefore engage a host of concerns, including those giant triplets that King noted. Moreover, the approach to addressing this challenge must come from a variety of sources, including the Protestant King, the Roman Catholic Wojtyła, the Jewish background at Brooks, and more. As they and others attest, the threat to persons is real. Moreover, the import for personalism today in addressing this threat has great merit. This book is one such attempt at addressing the problem of revealing what is missing: persons. This venture also provides a personalist moral framework that goes in search of finding missing personhood and to engage and empathize with individual instances of missing personhood in all their depth and complexity. This volume is a personalist philosophy of life or moral vision applied to various ethical issues in dialogue with various ethical systems in our pluralistic society today. Having disclosed what this book is, it is also important to indicate what it is not. It is not a social ethics, though it does engage social issues. It is not a manual for how to carry out individual ethical decisions. Neither does it approach various ethical issues from one dominant ethical system framed by a version of the good ideal, deontological ethics, good consequence, consequentialist ethics, or good and virtuous person, virtue ethics. Rather, it attempts to engage a variety of ethical systems in addressing 10 hot topic issues in pursuit of a personalist framework. No one representative of personalism or their focused set of ethical concerns will predominate either. For example, just as one might argue that there is more to King than personalism, so too there is more to this book than addressing King's version of personalism and the set of issues he addressed, namely economic exploitation, racism, and militarism. There is also more to this book than engaging Western ethical systems. As noted previously, our context today is a pluralistic society. I will articulate here a Trinitarian personalist faith in dialogue with various Western and Eastern traditions. After all, the world is at our doorstep and in the public square. We cross paths with people of various perspectives on an increasing basis and must seek to foster an open and dialogical posture of ethical engagement. The title of the book, More Than Things, A Personalist Ethics for a Throwaway Culture, includes the word more. What does more entail? Is it a facet of our being, such as a capacity? Better features through facelifts and weight loss? Better functions or roles to fill occupationally? Fame? Fortune? More and better perks for a faction or fraternity to which we belong? Something else? Something more? I will address various questions like these in the chapters that follow, beginning with laying the groundwork in Chapter 2, which will include providing the definitions and metaphysical framework of persons and personalism, as well as the methodology for our ethical pursuits. For now, suffice it to say that the more is not any of these options. A personalist framework claims that we are made for more than these things. Additionally, the more of personhood entails treating one another as more than mere means to a given party or institution's aims and ambitions. Individual persons are ends in themselves. The more also entails valuing the incommunicability of one another rather than reducing others to easily replaceable and throwaway parts in a system. This book will outline how we are made for more as persons in a variety of ethical domains in conversation with diverse ethical systems in our pluralistic society from the vantage point of faith, hope, and love. As noted previously, I will provide the underlying metaphysical and methodological framework in Chapter 2. There, I will highlight the categories of faith and entangled ethics, hope and eschatological ethics, and love and embodied ethics. Next, in parts 2 and 3, I will engage various ethical issues. Notice the sequential and directional trajectory across time and space, reflecting the ethical journey in search of missing persons. Part 2 opens with consideration of the beginning of life, abortion, and genetic engineering, then proceeds to sexuality and gender, and then terminates with the end of life and euthanasia across time. Part 3 begins with consideration of racism, which has been called America's original sin, proceeds to immigration reform, then across the globe with drone warfare and environmental care, and concludes with space exploration, the final ethical frontier. Notice how the more theme runs throughout the chapters. Ethical engagement requires more faith, hope, and love. We are more than our abilities and disabilities. We are more than our racialized in-group and out-group dynamics, and so on. The subjects in this book are contentious issues. I will provide a moral compass to help us navigate from a culture of things to a culture of persons in our pluralistic society. This is easier said than done, but it is worth the effort. Let's reflect briefly on what is entailed by the language of moral compass and its import for driving down the road in search of a culture that cherishes personhood. Installing and using the personalist moral compass involves the following: engaging ethical considerations with critical precision, having a charitable spirit for a posture, and cultivating constructive connections between various attempted moral solutions on pressing issues wherever possible. Personalism serves as the intended destination and a core component in the moral compass. This book's navigation system seeks to locate personhood, which is often missing, and provide the directions to find and secure personalist reality in its various manifestations. It will not be enough to simply know that personhood is often missing in societal actions and deliberations and what the destination is. If one wishes to reach one's personalist destination, it is also important that one's moral compass includes knowing and operating according to the rules of the road, as with deontological ethical inquiry. Moreover, a driver adapts to evolving road conditions, speeding up or slowing down due to the flow of traffic and inclement weather, as with consequentialist ethics. Furthermore, a good driver is ever alert to the whereabouts of other motorists rather than lost in space, dangerously distracted while listening to a favorite Spotify playlist at an ear-splitting volume. A good driver is also courteous, giving appropriate space to other motorists, signaling lane changes, and guarding against reacting to rude motorists and falling prey to road rage, as with virtue ethics. All three ethical models play important roles in seeking to avoid collisions and reaching one's personalist destination in one piece. We often take for granted certain personalist sensibilities until they are challenged and in danger of being defaced beyond recognition. We often take people for granted until they are gone, as in the case of missing persons. If we are to relocate and rescue personhood, we will need to pack wisely for the trip, including loading the vehicle with appropriate metaphysical and methodological considerations, which will be the subject matter of Chapter 2. There is a lot at stake, so it is time to get to work. We will more likely find what or who we are looking for in the end if we remain cognizant of the amber alerts and missing person notifications and make use of the moral compass this personalist paradigm provides. 2. More faith, hope, and love. Metaphysical and methodological conditions for a personalist moral vision. Cynicism, pessimism, and narcissism prevail in many quarters today. Traditional political and religious institutions and their leaders fail to inspire confidence in many circles, only suspicion or cynicism. To the extent we think we are on our own and that the established structures and officials who are supposed to ensure human flourishing are suspect, we will be hard-pressed to move forward and cultivate the common good. Pessimism may overtake us and foster despondence and despair. Alternatively, disillusionment with failed systems and leaders and the absence of secure attachments may move us toward narcissism and self-absorption, whereby we only seek to take care of ourselves and not also others in need. This chapter presents a personalist account of human life that secures faith, contra cynicism, hope, contra pessimism, and love, contra narcissism, on a transcendent and transcendental level, involving an emphasis on the higher good over and for the common good. This higher level orientation impacts morals and ethical activity. Thus, in keeping with the book's emphasis on more, I will highlight the need for accounting more fully for the triune faith, triune hope, and triune love. Such accounting makes it possible to navigate life in more expansive and enriching interpersonal and relational terms in this culture and societal moment. In what follows, I will articulate the metaphysical and methodological conditions for pursuing a personalist moral vision in our pluralistic society. These metaphysical and methodological conditions will serve as the moral compass trajectory for pointing from a culture of things to persons on each of the 10 ethical issues in parts 2 and 3 of this volume. There will be 3 sections: the triune faith and entangled ethics, the triune hope and eschatological ethics, and the triune love and embodied ethics. Each section will include 2 components, one vertical and one horizontal. The metaphysical framework to be put forth entails consideration of the vertical dimension of the triune faith, triune hope, and triune love. The methodological framework entails consideration of the horizontal dimension of faith in conversation with critical, realistic rationality in engaging a plurality of ethical systems in pursuit of humanity's hoped-for envisioned telos involving perfecting love of God and neighbor. The Triune Faith and Entangled Ethics. A personalist moral framework claims that we are made for more. It involves an expansive rather than reductionist account of humanity. I cannot exhaust the mystery of personhood. All personalist moral musings must involve the element of reverence, awe, and, in this volume, a faith-like awareness of the human creature's divine likeness that transcends knowledge. As C.S. Lewis stated, we have never encountered mere mortals. The personalist moral vision articulated in this book involves adherence to the triune faith of one God as 3 divine persons in eternal communion, in whose image we are made and constituted relationally, vertical. Such adherence shapes consideration of a variety of ethical issues involving faith and critical realism and rationality in dialogue with a plurality of personalist and non-personalist moral visions and ethical systems. Horizontal. Not everyone believes in a personalist vision of life. Not everyone who pursues it claims the triune faith and its distinctive form of personalism. Not everyone who pursues a personalist framework, Trinitarian or otherwise, does so in the same way. These various complexities signify that we are dealing with entangled ethical explorations. Such complex, messy, entangled interactions and explorations signify that none of us see life with a clear-as-crystal, God's-eye point of view. We all look through a glass dimly. A Trinitarian personalist moral vision should entail sustained, open engagement with various personalist and non-personalist positions and ethical approaches in our pluralistic society. This will include accounting for those whose ethical pursuits emphasize the good ideal, deontological ethics, the good result, consequentialist ethics, and the good person, virtue ethics. There is no place for cynical dismissals of the pursuit of the good from whatever quarter in our pluralistic society. A Trinitarian personalist moral vision must always account for the other and their positions, in all seriousness, given our interconnectedness, complexity, and ambiguities of life, and everyone's inherent value as human persons called to pursue the common good in view of the highest good, the triune good. Vertical. Roman Catholic theologian Hans-Urs von Balthasar argued that Trinitarian and Christological categories were instrumental in shaping the understanding of human person as more than a mere individual. Without that backdrop, it is quite likely that in the West, the understanding of person would not have exceeded the basic understanding of our typical notion of the individual human. One wonders if one could have made the move from individual to person, as Catholic philosopher Jacques Maritain did, if not for the Christian theological heritage. Balthasar quotes Maritain as stating, "The individual exists for the society, but the society exists for the person." This framework has huge implications, safeguarding against anarchy on the one hand and totalitarianism on the other hand. Still, it is not my intention in this immediate context to address the political implications arising from particular doctrines of the Christian faith. Rather, I intend to specify briefly what person signifies when in Trinitarian discourse we speak of one God in three persons, and Jesus of Nazareth as one person in two natures, divine and human. I will then consider the notion of humanity as created in the image of the triune God, and what that entails for human personhood. I will shape a definition of human personhood that resonates with Trinitarian theism and theological anthropology, but can also make space for non-Christian considerations. Divine persons in Trinitarian theology. The Athanasian Creed presents the doctrine of the Trinity in the following terms: that we worship one God in Trinity and the Trinity in unity, neither blending their persons nor dividing their essence. For the person of the Father is a distinct person, the person of the Son is another, and that of the Holy Spirit still another. But the divinity of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is one, their glory equal, their majesty co-eternal. The Chalcedonian Creed, AD 451, includes the following lines about Christ's identity as a person with two natures, one divine and the other human. One and the same Christ, Son, Lord, only begotten, to be acknowledged in two natures, without confusion, without change, without division, without separation, the distinction of natures being by no means taken away by the union, but rather the property of each nature being preserved and concurring in one person and one subsistence, not parted or divided into two persons, but one and the same Son, and only begotten, God the Word, the Lord Jesus Christ. Each of the divine persons retains their distinctive identity. The Father is not the Son, nor the Son the Father. The Father is always the Father of the Son, and the Son is always the Son of God the Father. As the eternally begotten, uncreated, and entirely unique Son, He is also the eternal Word who is the self-expression of God. The Spirit is also unique as the eternal Spirit of God and the Spirit of Christ. The Spirit is the Lord and Giver of life, as the Nicene Creed declares. Whereas the Son is eternally begotten, the Spirit eternally proceeds. The Father creates, redeems, and perfects the creation through the Son and Spirit. From the preceding reflections, we discover that each of the three divine persons retains the unique qualities of the Godhead, so that each is fully God, though not in isolation from the other two. Each has distinctive roles, which do not exhaust their persons, and which serve the harmonious activity of the entire Godhead. As to the identity of Jesus as divine and human, the second person of the Trinity becomes human, retaining his deity as the eternally begotten Son of God and eternal Word. Jesus is not two persons, but one person who has two natures, one being fully divine and the other being fully human. In each instance, the Trinity and Christology, we find that personhood is not an attribute or auxiliary feature. Personhood is as critically important to understanding who God and Christ are in Christian thought as is an understanding of divine and human natures. As those created in the image of God, we must account for each human person in all their distinctiveness as being important in addition to their shared humanity. We must cherish each human person as equal in worth and dignity. There were many missteps along the way in the formulation of Trinitarian orthodoxy. A few of those missteps were modalism, tritheism, and subordinationism. Modalism views the Father, Son, and Spirit as modes of God's being. Their distinctive particularity does not in any way constitute God. Thus, personhood does not go to the core of God's being. Nor does interpersonal reality serve as the ground of all life in a modalist framework. Tritheism views the persons as three gods. Thus, the three persons do not constitute one another relationally in the divine life. They are who they are in isolation from one another. Whereas modalism conveys the idea that God does not constitute creaturely life as personal, subordinationism signifies that God does not constitute creaturely life in the creation in personal terms as God. Jesus is a human being, but not fully God, co-equal and co-eternal with the Father and the Spirit may be viewed in impersonal terms. Human persons and the image of God. It is important to caution against a one-to-one correspondence between the three divine persons as the one God and human persons as fully human. The way in which the three persons are God is distinctive in that the three persons mutually indwell one another, perichoresis. Similarly, the two natures in the one person of Christ indwell one another. We can only speak analogically of human persons in communion. God's particular three-in-one reality and Christ's hypostatic union are sui generis, or one of a kind. This cautionary point calls to mind a significant recent debate, which I need to briefly address here. Recent literature on the Trinity has focused on deconstructing the histories and presuppositions of many socially minded theologies of the Trinity. However, little has been done to continue to explore the Trinity's social significance after the deconstruction ends. It is important to account for some of the recent criticisms of social Trinitarianism on the one hand, while moving forward with conceiving the import for ethics of the triune God's relational engagement with the world, on the other hand. One cannot provide sufficient grounds for sociality apart from a relational ontology. However, relational should not be so facilely contrasted to substance, as is sometimes argued. The doctrine of the Trinity provides a sure foundation in that the triune God's being or life is inherently relational, since the one God is the Father, Son, and Spirit existing eternally in communion. We should safeguard against projecting this divine relational reality as a construct onto all forms of sociality, for God's perichoretic relations are sui generis. After all, the divine persons are not independent centers of consciousness. Moreover, they share one divine will. Nonetheless, humans can still draw from God's triune revelation anagogical implications for how we are to live as divine image bearers. The image involves reflecting and participating in the life of God, who is inherently relational. In short, it is important to throw out the dirty bathwater, but not the baby. Often, encountering one reaction, a movement goes to the opposite extreme. Sometimes the pendulum swing may be from rationalism to relationalism and back again. According to Leslie Newbegin, many Christians have failed to account for Trinitarian thought forms. In his estimation, their concept of God is more like a supreme monad resulting from the combination of Greek philosophy and Islamic theology that was powerfully injected in the thought of Christendom at the beginning of the High Middle Ages, then by the thought of the fathers of the first four centuries. One might take issue with Newbegin's separation of the thought of the fathers of the first four centuries from what transpired at the beginning of the High Middle Ages. Instead, one might choose to place the blame for putting out of circulation Trinitarian thought forms at the feet of the Christian apologists in the early modern period in their defense against Spinoza and other budding atheists, as Michael Buckley does. Even so, Newbegin was right to lament the lack of attention to Trinitarian thought forms in his day. More recently, some have gone to the opposite extreme and employed the Trinity as a tool to promote a certain social agenda, or as Paul Molnar puts it, relationality has become the subject and God the predicate. This is nothing new. All too often, throughout Western history, politicians and preachers go in search of deities that make their polity points for them. Colin Gunton documented what he took to be an absence of Trinitarian reflection in the tradition and argued for the Trinity's import, including in the sphere of human governance. Later, he expressed concern over the facile employment of Trinitarian in theological discussions surrounding its reemergence. Newbegin did the same. Particular Trinitarian constructs were being developed in such a way that they overshadowed Christological categories and the thrust of the gospel in service to democratic notions of governance. What gives ground for anxiety here is the positing of a Trinitarian model against the model of Christocentric universalism. The doctrine of the Trinity was not developed in response to the human need for participatory democracy. It was developed in order to account for the facts that constitute the substance of the gospel. This volume's engagement of the import of Trinitarian thought forms for ethics seeks to navigate between the Scylla of social Trinitarianism and the Charybdis of a non-relational God and non-relational world. To navigate the extremes, we must consider the Father's particular work in the world through the personal operations of the Son and Spirit. In other words, Trinitarian mediation as revealed in God's concrete history, as disclosed in the biblical drama, explicates and circumscribes the way in which relationality is framed. This orientation safeguards analogical predication from projection involving implications arising from the doctrine of the Trinity. Now let's return to the significance of biblical and Trinitarian personalism for human personhood. If it were not for Judeo-Christian and Trinitarian, as well as Christological thought forms, we would be hard-pressed to assert that all human persons are created equal. There is nothing self-evident about the assertion of human equality. All one need do is look around and see that some people are smarter, stronger, richer, and more attractive. Throughout history, left to human ambition, those with the greatest capacities and related qualities most often prevail. The idea that we cannot reduce other persons to mere means to our own ends, no matter their status, or that each human person is fundamentally unique and inherently and equally precious, finds secure footing in the biblical notion that we are made in the image of the Lord God, who is supremely personal. It follows that we cannot, dare not, treat God's image-bearers in less than hallowed terms. Otherwise, we are taking God's name in vain. Those who misuse God's personal name readily misuse others. Here is how Exodus chapter 20 presents the matter of God's hallowed status as the Lord who brought Israel out of slavery into covenantal freedom with God and neighbor. And God spoke all these words, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name." Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 through 7. The care Israelites were to extend to their family, neighbors, and others in society in the 5th through the 10th commandments followed from honoring God. Loving the Lord God with all one's being and loving one's neighbor as oneself are the greatest commandments. Jesus summed up the law and prophets in this way. The most important one is this: "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength." The second is this: "Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these." Mark chapter 12, verses 29 through 31. As I proceed with consideration of human personhood, it is important to provide brief consideration of the nature of the image of God in view of the biblical account. Moreover, it will prove instructive to briefly discuss the biblical emphasis on the divine name, Lord, which appears in Exodus chapter 20, and which God discloses in his covenantal activity with his people. These motifs will serve to enhance consideration of all humans as equal and each human as unique. The primal text for thinking about human personhood is in Genesis chapter 1, where God creates both man and woman in God's image. "Then God said, 'Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground.' So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, 'Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground.'" Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 28. Karl Barth provides a discussion of several options posed by various scholars for understanding the image, including reason, dominion, moral qualities, and relationality. Barth believes relationality, as shown in the male and female together being created in the divine image, best conveys what is entailed by the image of God motif in Genesis chapter 1. Looking forward to the New Testament account of the divine image, Bart argues that the ultimate human image is Jesus in communion with his church. Such duality, differentiated unity, or communion, conveyed in this understanding of the image, reflects God's triunity. In his exposition of Genesis chapter 1, it is worth noting that Bart rejects the idea that the divine plural, let us, is merely a formal expression of dignity, and shows little patience for the modern dismissal of the early church's Trinitarian exposition of the Genesis chapter 1 account. Bart writes, "It may be stated that an approximation to the Christian doctrine of the Trinity, the picture of a God who is the one and only God, yet who is not, for that reason, solitary, but includes in himself the differentiation and relationship of I and thou, is both nearer to the text and does it more justice than the alternative suggested by modern exegesis in its arrogant rejection of the early church. Compare, for instance, Gunkel." Dietrich Bonhoeffer, whom Bart references approvingly in his treatment, also champions a relational understanding of the image. The likeness, the analogy of man to God, is not analogia entis, analogy of being, but analogia relationis, analogy of relation. This means that even the relation between man and God is not a part of man. It is not a capacity, a possibility, or a structure of his being, but a given, set relationship. And in this given relation, freedom is given. Bonhoeffer adds that the human person does not have this likeness in his possession, at his disposal. It is a God-given relation. As such, the image of God in humans continually depends on God for its continual existence and well-being. The likeness to God in humanity is fundamentally relational, entailing covenantal communion between God and the human creation, which God initiates, determines, and sustains. Moreover, as Bart points out, Christian scripture presents Jesus as the ultimate image of God. Colossians chapter 1, verse 15. We are created in God's image, but Jesus is that image. In keeping with the relational ontology articulated here, Jesus shares this image with his body, the church. Colossians chapter 1, verse 18. Bart writes, "This Christological equation has at the root an inclusive character, so that it is also an ecclesiological, and therefore even an anthropological, equation. Human persons and irrevocable dignity and worth." It is important to note in this context, following Bart and Bonhoeffer, that while qualities like reason, dominion or rule, and moral virtue play their parts in human existence, they do not eclipse the constitutive relational reality of the divine image in humanity. Those with greater capacities, such as reason, opportunities, and successes through rule and riches, do not possess the image to a greater extent than others. Moreover, while we can sin against God's image, we cannot lose it since we never had possession of it, as Bart asserts. It is, after all, a constitutive, covenantal relation. Certainly moral qualities matter in keeping with God's call to his people to honor his name and obey his commands. But like reason, good character does not add to the image, but features and expresses the image in all its glory. This constitutive relation is what grounds or confirms human dignity. What Christian Smith might frame in natural theological terms comes forth here in supernatural theological terms. One cannot add to, or subtract from, human worth or dignity. It is basic to one's person. God's image, as revealed in Scripture, provides that basis. Speaking of God's covenantal engagement with humanity, it is worth noting how God takes seriously naming his people. God also instructs us to honor God's name, which he reveals to Moses. This emphasis on naming safeguards against commodification of God and humanity in the Hebrew Scriptures. Commodification entails treating others as mere means to one's own ends, which involves using them, exchanging them for profit, and abusing them. R. Kendall Solon develops this point in view of the divine name to striking effect. In his essay, Go Tell Pharaoh, or Why Empires Prefer a Nameless God, Solon references Edward Gibbon's line about forms of worship during the reign of the Caesars. The multiple expressions of worship were considered by the people equally true, by the philosophers equally false, and by the magistrates equally useful. A deity that was ultimately nameless could be commodified so that an empire's subjects could be commodified for the sake of an empire's expansion. Solon draws attention to Moses' exchanges with Pharaoh, who was likely familiar with the doctrine of God as nameless and indefinable, and may have had it in mind when dismissing Moses' claim. "Who is the Lord, that I should obey him and let Israel go? I do not know the Lord, and I will not let Israel go." Exodus chapter 5, verse 2. Solon also alludes to the episode in the temple in Jerusalem involving Antiochus Epiphanes, who no doubt believed that Israel's God is simply a tribal nomination for the nameless deity to whom he sought to offer homage with pagan sacrifices at their altar. These pagan rulers soon realized that Israel and its God will not go quietly. We see how often empires and their rulers wanted to make a name for themselves at the expense of individuals and individual people groups throughout the Bible. Take, for example, Genesis chapter 11. Though preceded and followed by genealogies in Genesis chapter 10 and chapter 11, as well as followed by God's calling of Abram in Genesis chapter 12, involving his aim to make Abram's name great, the people who come together from across the earth are nameless. Those in power sought to make a name for themselves at the expense of others. As Sheila Tuller Keiter observes, "Building the Tower of Babel became of such paramount importance that bricks became more valuable than human beings. The builders ignored the divine source behind each individual and willingly sacrificed them to the building project. And, in so doing, they challenged God's authority as creator." Something similar to the Babel account happens with Pharaoh's rule and the subjugation of the Jewish people as slaves. Their dehumanizing subjection was ultimately an attempt by Pharaoh to challenge God's rule and elevate himself over God's people. Pharaoh underestimated God's resolve to defend his people and judge Egypt as a nation. Interestingly, the Babel narrative and the Exodus drama depict the rulers and their peoples as nameless. In striking contrast, God names his people. Exodus begins with a genealogy that accounts for the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. With the ascendance of the new Pharaoh, the names disappear. Only with Moses' deliverance under Pharaoh's daughter and God's providential mercy is this trend reversed. In contrast, the biblical accounts choose to keep the Pharaoh and his daughter nameless. Egypt's dehumanizing subjugation of Israel involving namelessness leads to their own namelessness and undoing under God's judgment. For Keiter, the implications are clear. One cannot deny the divine spirit in others without denying the divine spirit in all men. One cannot dehumanize others without dehumanizing one's self. Moving forward to the New Testament, Peter declares that in and through the name of Jesus, Acts chapter 3, verse 16, chapter 4, verses 7 through 12, he healed a nameless, lame beggar. This individual was someone for whom the governing authorities appeared to care little, except that his healing brought about massive interest in the apostolic message centered in the crucified and risen Jesus. While namelessness easily leads to dehumanization and commodification, the proclamation of exclusive salvation through the indispensable triune name revealed in Jesus leads to humanization for the nameless, lame beggar, and countless others. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven but Jesus by whom God saves people. Acts chapter 4, verse 12. The Lord does not enslave or use people, but liberates them. We are not mere means, but ends in ourselves. The destruction of Babel and the humiliation of Pharaoh in the Exodus are ultimately intended to liberate nameless peoples from oppressive rule, including Egyptians and others who went with Israel. Exodus chapter 12, verse 38. Israel is to deal graciously with aliens or strangers, as they were once themselves aliens in a foreign land. Exodus chapter 22, verse 21. One of the most striking examples of such mercy is found in the story of Ruth. The law and the prophets give clear and exact instructions on treating others fairly, especially those on the margins. See Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 18. Zechariah chapter 7, verse 10. The Sabbath itself was intended as a mercy to provide all God's people with rest from exacting work. After all, they had experienced no rest from their labor under Pharaoh, and yet its aim was distorted by the teachers of the law as an exacting burden that kept them from acting mercifully toward the people entrusted to their care. Thus, Jesus goes to great lengths to heal people on the Sabbath. After all, humanity was not a means to an end of honoring the Sabbath. Rather, the Sabbath was a means to an end of honoring the Son of Man as Lord of the Sabbath and humanity as the chief of God's works. Matthew chapter 12, verse 8, Mark chapter 2, verse 27. See also Mark chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Several traits characteristic of the image of God doctrine in Scripture bear on our understanding in this chapter of the human person. Physicality and spirituality, or embodied spirit, relationality, autonomy, non-instrumentality, freed from Egypt, and non-repeatability, known by name, all stand out in this discussion. Given the account of Jesus as the ultimate image of God in Scripture, there is also a teleological or eschatological component as God perfects us in Christ through the Spirit. As the ideal human, Jesus loves God with all his heart, soul, mind, and strength, and his neighbor as himself. Jesus is the Jewish apocalyptic Son of Man in the canonical Gospel accounts. He also manifests the ideal qualities of the Samaritan of astounding mercy in the parable of Luke, chapter 10, verses 25 through 37. Colin Gunton accounts for a variety of these motifs in his own theological treatment of the person created in God's image. For Gunton, to be a created person entails four key features. First, an inescapable relation to God through the Son and Spirit. Second, a response of praise and thanksgiving to God with their entire being, involving soul and body in freedom and love. Third, mutually constitutive communal relations with the triune God and with one another as male and female and care for the good order of the entire creation. Here, Gunton locates key aspects of human personality and our distinctive calling, including freedom, responsibility, and creativity. These features of personhood give rise to a fourth, namely, a personalist ethic that arises from this understanding of the image of God. Gunton writes, "Finally, being in the image of God implies there an ethic according to which human life is ordered appropriately to both the personal and the non-personal creation. All are called to relations of love in freedom with others so imaged. All are called to represent God to the creation. This ethic is a consequence of being in the image and, like the image itself, takes its orientation from the vertical relation of humankind to God. The triune God serves as the vertical dimension for our particular personalist conception of life and ethical inquiry. How does one bring that conception to bear on public discourse in a pluralistic society? In what follows, consideration will focus on the needed dialogical approach to personalist ethics, given the entangled and complex web of perspectives and pursuits in our pluralistic age." Horizontal. The preceding discussion arises from an account of the Judeo-Christian heritage and Christian theology. It is not that the Jewish and Christian scriptures alone highlight various qualities of divine and human personhood. It is simply that biblical and theological explorations made a significant impact on the concept of personhood in the West. It is worth mentioning that one can find Buddhist, Confucianist, and Hindu personalist treatments. Acknowledging and comparing personalist trajectories in various traditions is not without its challenges. Take, for example, the Jewish philosopher Martin Buber and the Protestant theologian Karl Barth. Both were personalists. Buber's concept of I and thou finds resonance in Barth's analysis of the dialogical character of humanity. While Barth wonders if certain non-Christian figures, such as the pagan Confucius, the atheist L. Feuerbach, and the Jew M. Buber, have the same idea in mind when discussing this dialogical notion of humanity, he affirms Buber's and these other treatments. Still, as Buber notes, Barth struggles in the midst of strong affirmation with whether this dialogical notion of humanity could have grown on any other ground than the Christological, Jesus Christ as the man for his fellow men and thus the image of God. For his part, Buber applauds Barth's humane breadth of spirit and original explorations, while also highlighting their independence from one another as a Hasidic Jewish philosopher and a Protestant Christian theologian. The German philosopher Immanuel Kant also manifests personalist sensibilities. Take, for example, his categorical imperative that we should not treat people as mere means to ends, but ends in themselves. Act in such a way that you always treat humanity, whether in your own person or in the person of any other, never simply as a means, but always at the same time as an end. As in the case of Buber and Barth, Kant is downstream from the biblical tradition. Regardless of his own attempts to provide rational grounds for ethics, apart from any revelation claims or emotional influences, Kant's thought reflects the Christian heritage of his parents. Alistair MacIntyre claims that Kant's Lutheran heritage made an indelible impression on him. Kant inherited his morality from his pious parents and sought to put it on firm, rational, moral grounds. However, Kant was not able to put his system on entirely rational foundation stones. For example, asserting that one can treat others as a mere means to one's own ends may lack virtue, but it is not inconsistent. It would also be consistent for a world made up entirely of egoists to treat one another as mere means to their own respective ends. So, it is easier said than done to outline a moral strategy that safeguards against conceiving people as generic or homogeneous objects by reason alone. No matter how hard it is to provide purely rational safeguards for human persons against objectifying and homogenizing forces, the Christian theologian operating in a pluralistic society should welcome whatever help she or he can get. More hands make less work, and the work to safeguard human persons and the world at large from disparagement and pulverization is quite intense and taxing. Moreover, given the distrust in many circles of Christendom, it is all the more important for Christians to engage from a humble, listening, and dialogical posture. The full display of human depravity by Christian and non-Christian alike in our society has not undone the predominant sense of disgust and horror that most people feel when they experience abuse, that is, feel used. No one in their right mind desires to endure exploitation where others treat them as objects or tools or view them as mere numbers rather than view them as fundamentally unique and irreplaceable. It appears that we are all wired in this way. So it would not prove detrimental to complement Judeo-Christian thought forms supporting personalism with what is deemed naturalist considerations. After all, we all look through a glass dimly. Only in the eschaton will we perceive divine and human personhood face to face with crystal clarity. One of the most significant contributions to personalist thought in recent scholarship is sociologist Christian Smith's What is a Person? Smith offers an extra-biblical account of the person that draws in part from Aristotelian teleology and evolutionary scientific thought forms. His aim is a noble one: to reframe the social sciences to account front and center for the importance of the person in their various research pursuits. Here is Smith's robust and multifaceted definition. What, then, is a person? By person, I mean a conscious, reflexive, embodied, self-transcending center of subjective experience, durable identity, moral commitment, and social communication who, as the efficient cause of his or her own responsible actions and interactions, exercises complex capacities for agency and intersubjectivity in order to develop and sustain his or her own incommunicable self in loving relationships with other personal selves and with the non-personal world. That, in any case, is what a normal person is, a person who has developed normally. Apart from consideration of the vertical Trinitarian framework articulated in Gunton's assessment of the human person, Smith is a Roman Catholic who embraces Trinitarian thought forms, I find here a great deal of overlap. While Gunton does not emphasize, but no doubt assumes, the rational and reflexive aspects of personhood, given his focus on relationality, Gunton and Smith both account for human subjectivity, moral commitment, and social communication. Gunton also assumes or suggests durable identity, while both Smith and Gunton account for persons as responsible and free human agents operating in their embodied states in loving, harmonious relationships with fellow humans and the non-human world. Smith also guards against reductionism in the natural domain by discussing the evolutionary development and emergence of the person from lower-level entities, as well as the person's downward causation on lower-level entities. It is important to point out that Smith's definition, with its mention of normal, does not lead him to discount radically damaged individuals as persons. They are persons, though Smith claims it is not a helpful move to somehow discount the differences between normal and damaged persons. The last item to note, by way of comparison, is that, while Gunton does not make space for Aristotelian teleology or evolutionary thought forms in his theological treatment of human personhood, he does draw on his colleague John Zizioulas's understanding of person as ultimately an eschatological concept that will be realized in God's future kingdom. Perhaps it is fair to say that all persons, no matter their state of ability or moral virtue for that matter, await perfection. Gunton states in this context, "Because creation is a project, that is to say, something to be perfected, being in the image of God is also being in movement to an end." Shortly, I will turn to the metaphysical account of hope and eschatological ethics and its bearing on our personalist project. However, before doing so, it is important to develop further the entangled ethics motif. Mention was made previously that Smith offers an extra-biblical assessment of personhood given his secular audience for the volume. There is much that we find beneficial in his assessment of personhood and view his project in complementary terms. In this present volume, consideration of personhood and a personalist ethic will go in search of favorable dialogue partners across the ideological spectrum. Not all those constructive dialogue partners will be personalists, but nonetheless they will view humanity and all of life in non-instrumentalist and non-reductionist terms. Since we all look through a glass dimly and indwell a pluralistic society where there is not even a remote sense of consensus regarding ethical valuations, we must work as collaboratively as possible. I, for one, embrace a critical, realist, personalist account of epistemology, as does Smith. I believe in objective truth and maintain we must make our best case for a given position, namely a personalist moral vision, in the public square of civil discourse and debate. I must also acknowledge that, based on human finitude and human depravity, we do not always perceive and argue rightly. Even when I maintain that the personalist position makes the best sense of life for virtuous human flourishing, those of other traditions, or no tradition at all, may object. In those cases, which are quite common, one must remain civil, patient, open to correction and new insight, even as one continues to reason with others in the effort to present a personalist moral vision as most plausible and compelling. I mentioned previously that there is no consensus in moral deliberations, including about what is the common good, in society. McIntyre puts it this way: "The most striking feature of contemporary moral utterance is that so much of it is used to express disagreements, and the most striking feature of the debates in which these disagreements are expressed is their interminable character. I do not mean by this just that such debates go on and on and on, although they do, but also that they apparently can find no terminus. There seems to be no rational way of securing moral agreement in our culture." For his part, McIntyre presents an Aristotelian and Thomistic account of virtue, while critiquing deontological ethical systems of the rationalist sort, as well as emotivist and institutionist systems. I offer no such overarching ethical critique of given systems, but rather seek to navigate and engage a variety of ethical systems on particular topics in pursuit of our personalist moral vision. What guides me at every turn is the Trinitarian conception of personhood and compatible and parallel ethical considerations wherever they might arise, as well as an interest in engaging deontological, consequentialist, and virtue ethical systems of thought at various junctures along the way. Certainly, the Judeo-Christian and Trinitarian metaphysical account of personhood shapes my faith convictions and moral pursuits on the 10 topics for ethical consideration set forth in parts 2 and 3 of this volume. Still, I choose to remain dialogical and open to collaborating, wherever possible, with proponents of various religious and philosophical ethical traditions in our entangled ethical world. The variety of positions, whether deontological, that is, the good ideal, consequentialist, that is, the good result, or teleological, that is, the good or noble individual, may lead one to start at different places and end up at different destinations in our determinations. But the effort to pursue common ground for the sake of human flourishing is worth the effort. I will attempt to bring the Christian faith to bear on ethical deliberations in a critically realist, personalist manner. My hope is that while we all look through a glass dimly, now with fallen and fallible powers of faith, limited spiritual discernment and reason, God will guide us so that someday, together, we shall see face to face. The Triune Hope and Eschatological Ethics. We all long for more. No matter how one views our being, made for more, as created in the image of God and or through procreation and evolutionary forces, we are called, predisposed, or wired to pursue that good that completes us as humans. Of course, there is no consensus in our pluralistic society on what that good end or telos is. For its part, the biblical personalist tradition presents the great commandments, love of God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, the highest good, and love of neighbor as ourselves, the common good, as that twofold end. Mark chapter 12, verses 28 through 34. Even so, knowing something to be one's end and successfully realizing or acquiring it are two different matters entirely. Our fallen human condition gets in the way. Just as the complexities and ambiguities of life might lead some to cynicism regarding the possibility of ever finding out the truth about the good and all it entails, so the fragility and depravity that mar our human condition can lead us to pessimism. Augustine's reflections on the tortured soul, cheated soul, diseased soul, and blessed soul have a bearing on this theme of eschatological hope. The tortured soul sees the good, but cannot attain it. The cheated soul believes he or she has the good, but is deceived. The diseased soul is the one who has the good, but does not realize or cherish it. In contrast, the blessed soul is the one who has the good and treasures it. For most, if not all, this blessed state of existence awaits us on the other side of the veil. No matter how hard we try, we find that we cannot attain that blessed end on our own. Bob Dylan, who wrote a song about dreaming of St. Augustine, sings in Blind Willie McTell of God being in heaven and how we all aspire to want to be like God. However, down here on earth, the only things that appear to be real are greed and power and our corruptible seed. How will we ever make it to heaven or bring heaven to earth? For all their differences, the Roman Catholic, Orthodox, and Protestant traditions would agree that we cannot lift ourselves up by our own bootstraps and attain perfection. The God of all grace and mercy must lead the way. God must align our hearts with what the highest good and common good are and energize us to realize that end or telos for which we were made, and thereby experience the blessed life. The triune God, who is the hope of the world, will make all things right. As Martin Luther King Jr. declared, quoting from James Russell Lowell's poem, "The cross on which the word of truth hangs is the scaffold that sways the future." So too, The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. Vertical. In view of the triune God who is our inspiring and energizing hope, we pursue our personalist moral vision and telos through entangled ethical inquiry in our pluralistic society. Horizontal. Vertical. Ours is an entangled, messy world, made up of many complex and often competing views. It is also a world that is messed up. According to Christian scripture, the triune God works in our midst in less than ideal conditions, with less than ideal ethical subjects, in pursuit of perfection. To use Irenaeus's language, God works through his two hands, the Son and the Spirit, to transform history from the inside out. Before I proceed further in this section, it would be helpful to pause and reflect further on the use of the terms vertical and horizontal. As already noted, in this chapter I am dividing each of the respective sections on faith, hope, and love into two parts, vertical and horizontal. Vertical does not necessarily entail supernatural in contrast to natural. It can simply mean ideal in contrast to the natural or normal state of affairs. In what follows, I will examine three figures, Jesus, the historical Buddha, and Aristotle, in order to present how vertical as an ideal state may operate, as well as to shine light on the particular divine personalist ideal revealed in Jesus's teaching and activity. Jesus certainly had in mind a heaven and a heavenly Father, as well as a kingdom of heaven that, while inaugurated in his person and teaching, nonetheless awaits consummation. If we extend consideration of vertical to other traditions in our entangled world of ethical systems, we find that the historical Buddha bracketed off consideration of a god or gods as well as a heavenly domain. His way of thinking was atheistic, not to be equated with Western notions of atheism. Nirvana is a transcendent or ideal dimension free from the grasping state of suffering and recurring cycle of rebirth. Aristotle certainly entertained notions of deity. However, the gods on Aristotle's view are exclusively intellectual realities whose wisdom we would do well to emulate in our pursuit of perfection in the Greek city-state. However, there is no sense of a personal relationship with these gods, as in Jesus' conception of God as a heavenly Father. At best, we find with Aristotle an unmoved mover. Each of these three figures entertained teleological accounts of perfection. More will be said about their respective teleological accounts of perfection in the horizontal section to follow. Such perfection for Jesus entails loving as God loves. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 provides a beautiful account of what love entails on an interpersonal level. Such love is eternal. The ultimate hope for Christians entails the conviction that such love will be realized in our human experience. More will be said on what Christian love entails in the next section. The ideal standard of perfection for the New Testament is found in the triune personal God as expressed in the divine law of the Sermon on the Mount. In contrast, the ideal standard for discerning perfection and imperfection in Buddhism and in Aristotle is a natural form of law. For Buddhism, this law is karma. For Aristotle, it is natural law, which is a form of judgment that takes shape in concrete manifestations in political communities, rather than a set of principles or standards that we apply unilaterally to every situation. Regarding the Buddhist conception of natural law or karma, leading Buddhist scholar Walpola Rahula claims the following. The theory of karma should not be confused with so-called moral justice or reward and punishment. The idea of moral justice or reward and punishment arises out of the conception of a supreme being, a God, who sits in judgment, who is a lawgiver, and who decides what is right and wrong. The term justice is ambiguous and dangerous, and in its name more harm than good is done to humanity. The theory of karma is the theory of cause and effect, of action and reaction. It is a natural law, which has nothing to do with the idea of justice or reward and punishment. Every volitional action produces its effects or results. Rahula claims that ambiguity results from belief in a supreme being sitting in judgment. Some theists have also raised concern over God operating in an arbitrary manner and have proposed that God is subject to the moral laws of the universe. While I share the concern over any law being arbitrarily imposed, I maintain that God does not operate in an arbitrary manner. The moral laws of the universe flow from His character, which are on display in the life and work of Jesus Christ as disclosed in the Bible. There is nothing arbitrary about Jesus' life story. He is constant in all His ways as the ultimate revelation of God, the incarnation of what Greek philosophy often referred to as the true, the good, and the beautiful. Moreover, I take great comfort in the biblical conviction that the moral ground, grid, and goal of the universe is personal and relational. The Father grounds justice, the Son embodies it, and the Spirit completes or perfects it. There is nothing arbitrary about this personal God's love, in contrast to certain Buddhist critiques. It is centered in the reality of Jesus Christ as gracious and truthful. Contrary to impersonal karma, God's judgment is very personal, though constant, in keeping with His covenantal purposes revealed in Jesus. God's personal judgment signifies that we are personally responsible. We are not things. We have dignity. Contrary to the view that the Judeo-Christian tradition enslaves people, we find here the fundamental basis for personal and interpersonal freedom. Various philosophers, theologians, and ethicists have eschatological visions. Plato taught that through the process of anamnesis, or recollection, we reawaken and clearly perceive the eternal forms in which we participate. Our souls participate in the eternal forms of truth, goodness, and beauty beyond the cycle of reincarnation. Irenaeus wrote on the recapitulation or transformation of history through God's incarnate Son and the outpoured Spirit. Immanuel Kant presented the ideas of the existence of God, immortality of the soul, and coming judgment as postulates of reason in the effort to safeguard morality. Friedrich Nietzsche set forth the doctrine of eternal recurrence, whereby we will live each moment of every day as if we will experience this same life forever. In our secular age, space exploration can serve as a contemporary secular eschatology, as will be developed in the final chapter of this volume. The historical Buddha did not appear to hold to the idea of an afterlife, but rather an end to rebirth afterlife with the realization of nirvana. Similarly, Aristotle rejected the Platonic idea of reincarnation. The soul's existence ends with the termination of physical life. Perfection is the pursuit of a transcendent ideal in this life. Further to what was stated previously in the case of Irenaeus's doctrine of recapitulation, Jesus' eschatological vision involved the inbreaking of God's kingdom in His life and ministry, and the consummation of that perfect state with His return at the climax of history in the fullness of the Spirit. I will return to a comparison of Jesus, Buddha, and Aristotle in the upcoming section to address their respective conceptions of teleological perfection. For now, we will unpack how Jesus' Beatitudes in the Sermon on the Mount present us with a view of more as eschatological perfection. There are different views of perfection and what more entails. Sometimes we realize that the more is not what we had been looking or hungering or thirsting for in life. For Jesus, the more is righteousness. Sometimes the more is less, as we find in the following Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are the meek. Matthew chapter 5, verses 3 through 5. The kingdom of the personal God, whose name is disclosed in Jesus of Nazareth as Lord, looks very different from the empire of nameless deity. Jesus' view of more entails a radically different conception of reality than what is found in the Pax Romana, or Peace of Rome. Jesus inaugurates God's kingdom in the shadow of Rome's empire. In contrast to Rome's empire that blesses the rich in spirit, Jesus' kingdom blesses the poor in spirit, Matthew chapter 5, verse 3. In contrast to Rome's empire that blesses the comfortable, Jesus' kingdom blesses those who mourn, Matthew chapter 5, verse 4. In contrast to Rome's empire that blesses those displaying violent strength, Jesus' kingdom blesses the meek, Matthew chapter 5, verse 5. In contrast to Rome's empire that blesses those who are already satisfied and possess all that the world has to offer, Jesus' kingdom blesses those who hunger not for stuff, but for justice and righteousness, Matthew chapter 5, verse 6. In contrast to Rome's empire that blesses those who are merciless and retributive, Jesus' kingdom blesses those who are merciful, Matthew chapter 5, verse 7. In contrast to Rome's empire that blesses those who revel in lust, greed, and vengeance, Jesus' kingdom blesses the pure of heart, Matthew chapter 5, verse 8. In contrast to Rome's empire that blesses those who keep Rome's violent peace, Jesus' kingdom blesses those who make peace between warring factions, Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. In contrast to Rome's empire that blesses those who persecute the righteous, Jesus' kingdom blesses those who are persecuted for righteousness, Matthew chapter 5, verse 10. Blessed are the poor in spirit. They don't see themselves as those who have arrived in terms of personhood. They need God's interpersonal intervention to attain perfection. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn. They lament their instrumentalist inclination and the world system's preoccupation with impersonal forces of commodification and mechanization. They will be comforted. Blessed are the meek. They guard against exercising uncontrollable power to seize the earth and its bounty and to divide and conquer. They will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. They do not treat people and creation as impersonal means to their own self-satisfaction. They will be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful. They see their own need for mercy in the other needing their mercy. They will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart. They do not conceive eye for an eye judgment and pursue retribution against their enemy. They do not other the other as less than their in-group, but see everyone as interpersonally connected, including those whom they would otherwise destroy. They will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers. They reject efforts to keep the peace when it is indifferent, violent, and oppressive in nature. They pursue peace with those who are very different, rather than discount and seek to destroy them. These peacemakers will be called sons and daughters of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness, the kind of righteousness on display in the Beatitudes and Sermon on the Mount. They are willing to suffer personally for Jesus' personalist vision. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven here on earth. They contend against what King calls a racialized, economically exploitative, and militarized world. They seek to move from a culture of things to a culture of persons as they follow Jesus, who is the decentered deity. He is decentered in that he turns everything inside out and upside down from his cross, which is the scaffold that frames history. Perched on his shoulders on the cross, we see how we are made for more than what the impersonal, enslaving, or commodifying and mechanistic world system has to offer. Notice how the first and last Beatitudes of poor in spirit and persecuted for righteousness bookend the others with, "Theirs is the kingdom of heaven." It is not that Jesus' followers bring about the kingdom through their actions. Rather, Jesus, who is their Lord, who reveals their spiritual poverty and on account of whom they are persecuted for righteousness, brings it about in their lives. As a result, they will be comforted as they mourn with him, inherit the earth as they are meek with him, be satisfied as they hunger and thirst for righteousness with him, receive mercy as they are merciful with him, see God as they are pure of heart with him, and be called children of God as they are peacemakers with him. Everything flows from his being with them. God with them, Emmanuel. Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. In view of him, there can be no sense of Aristotle's virtue of greatness of soul, which entails being worthy of great things and being conscious of it. As one finds here, it is not universally agreed that greatness of soul is a virtue. The Beatitudes in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, "Blessed are the poor in spirit," and "Blessed are the meek," Matthew chapter 5, verses 3 through 5, strongly suggest the contrary. Yet Nietzsche, in the late 19th century, fiercely rejected Christian humility and recommended something like Aristotelian great souledness instead. Nietzsche also rejected Christian love of neighbor, which Aristotle would also have found difficult to accept, unless that neighbor is of the noble, virtuous class, as we will note in the section to follow on embodied love. McIntyre acknowledges that Aristotle's account of the virtues differs substantially in content from the New Testament's depiction of what he terms virtues. He also claims that Aristotle would certainly not have admired Jesus Christ, and he would have been horrified by St. Paul. Still, McIntyre maintains that the New Testament account of the virtues has the same logical and conceptual structure as Aristotle's account. Such parallelism, which entailed the attainment of the human telos through the exercise and internalization of virtues, made it possible for St. Thomas Aquinas to set forth a synthesis of Aristotle and the New Testament. I will briefly note this presumed parallelism at a later point in the horizontal section, to which we now turn. Horizontal. We mentioned at the outset of this section on hope that, as Dylan sang, we all want what belongs to God, presumably such qualities as righteousness and justice. Still, all we seem to find here on earth is corruption. Things are rather messed up here below. But that does not, or should not, deter us from pursuing perfection. Consideration of advance, progress, and the pursuit of perfection drives the human spirit and imagination.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.